All right. Good afternoon, everybody. How are you? Energy level super high in this room? You can do better than that. I have a quick question before we start. How many, stand up if this is your first conference since February of 2019? All right. Yeah, me too. It feels a little weird, doesn't it? It feels a little weird. Welcome to this panel session. Thank you so much for coming and getting tested and jumping through all the hoops. My name is Chris Pirie. I'm the CEO of the Learning Futures Group, and I've interrupted my gap year to come to this conference because I love it so much, and I had the awesome opportunity to meet these people, so I wanted to take it. On our panel, in no particular order, we have Todd from NovoEd. NovoEd have an awesome platform for collaborative learning. We have Irina from Class, who are bringing an amazing set of learner-centric and teacher-centric applications to the Zoom platform. Some of you may have heard of that and maybe spent all of last year on it. We have Michael from Arist, who are using your cell phone and SMS-based text messaging to help you learn. And we have Ulrik from Area 9, who have a range of technologies, and I would say, I've oversimplified all your products, and you can fill me in. But really, it's about personalization of learning in many different facets, and you've been in business for 25 plus years. What all of these guys are doing is really something very important, I think, and that is they're trying to bring some humanity and some human-centric thinking to the digital learning experience. And I think we'll check this in a second, but I think they're all experiencing extraordinary growth given this crazy 18 months that we've all just gone through. So what I want to do is get their sense of the near future of technology, what they've learned through this sort of chaotic year, and their pointers at what they think is going to happen in the future around digital learning technology. It's an extraordinary time. So let's start by looking backwards. History is always a good indicator of what's going to happen. I think it was, I did some research, and it was January of 2001. John Chambers of Cisco famously said that education over the internet is going to be so big that it's going to make email usage look like a rounding error. So my first question for all of you is, was he right? And what technologies and what breakthroughs do you think we've had in the learning space in the last 20 years? Why don't you start, Ulrik?
Sure. So I think he will be right, but I think his timeline was probably too compressed. I think that one of the things we've underestimated is that there is an ecosystem, particularly in K-12, that needs to evolve with the technology. And Thomas Frey a few years ago was out saying that the largest company on the internet in 2030 would be an education company that nobody had heard of at that point. So I think that this perspective of education in the digital space is going to be a massive player in the future. But I do think that you have to be a lot more patient than both investors and a lot of the futurists have had the willingness to be in the past, that it does take longer. Like I've constantly thought that it was about 10 years away, and I still believe it's about 10 years away before you have that kind of scale. But we do have a lot more scale than we had 20 years ago, 25 years ago when I started in this space. So I profoundly believe that it's going to massively change, but not necessarily in the way that people think.
Okay. Any sort of technologies that emerged in that period of time that you think have been game changers?
Well, so if anybody are old enough to remember the CD-ROMs, like and the internet kind of like has had the same had been through the same phase, right? Where we were focusing more on the medium, but than what we did with it. So like it was a big mistake in the 90s for everybody who thought that their future lied on CD-ROMs, or in the 80s on laser discs. And it's the perspective on that that has changed, that we've moved from being focused on technology, particularly the last 18 months. We've moved from focusing on the internet or digital to being like, what do we do with it? And I actually think it's learning technology much more than the modality, whether it's laser discs or CD-ROMs or the internet or whatever it is, but actually what we can do with technology in education in a much broader sense. And I think that's the big breakthrough over the last year, is that it's much more about learning science and real learning engineering more than like, can we deliver it via a screen?
The job to be done, so to speak. Yeah. Michael, I think you probably don't know what a CD-ROM is.
I'm afraid I remember it when I was like maybe 4 or 5.
And how old were you when John Chambers made his statement that launched so many business plans in 2001?
Two.
Two, okay.
Yeah, I agree, I think he will be right and eventually. I think the biggest challenge has been thus far, that you know, the beauty of the internet and the beauty of technology is that it brings the world to us. Right? We don't have to go to the world comes to us in every way imaginable. And I think that's the thing that learning has gotten wrong so far, right? And digital learning in particular has gotten wrong so far. We haven't really leaned into the fact, bless you by the way, we haven't really leaned into the fact that you know, technology can bring learning to us in you know, the modalities that we use on a day-to-day basis, right? Today, if you're a learner you know, at a company or in K-12 or at a university, to a high degree, whether you're you know, learning in person or learning digitally, you have to go to where the learning is, right? You have to go to a platform, you have to jump into an LMS. If you're in person, you have to go to a session. And I think especially now with tools like Slack and Teams and Text and WhatsApp, we have a really unique opportunity to bring learning to the people. And I think that will finally realize what John Chambers was saying. So that's what I think.
Okay, I like it. Good millennial point of view on that. Everything comes to you.
but not in a self-centered way. It's just it should come to me.
Yeah, just right. It should. Yeah. Let me go to the end and ask Irina the same question. What technologies in the last 20 years do you think have really made an impact in our space?
I think it's not just technology. I think it's exactly what we just went through and are still going through, which is this COVID pandemic. It's completely changed where people work, how they live, how they learn. And so, you know, we at Class completely agree with that point. Technology and education is coming to you. We build over Zoom because it works and we all know it, but absolutely, we think that the only way to broaden education to make it more accessible and equitable is to bring it to people where they can access it. And the way you do it is you build on technology that works, that's proven, that's scalable, and then you really, that's where the magic happens, because that's when you can really start to create bespoke experiences for students. You can really personalize learning and really, really, coming back to that quote, really make that a reality.
Yeah. I think, you know, it's interesting that your strategy of taking a ubiquitous technology that's designed for digital collaboration and then bringing learning, you know, bringing tools that make it work for learning, for a learning context, is really, really interesting. And I think a lot of the business plans that John Chambers launched 20 years ago were about building the learning platform itself. And I think it's a really interesting pivot to say, you know, learning is collaboration, learning is content, learning is a lot of different things, but it requires some specialized content, some specialized functionality around that.
Yeah, I mean, just to build on that, you need an infrastructure, you need foundations, right? You couldn't do email without the rest of the internet, right? And so I think we're at that same point now, where we have finally infrastructure, we finally have something that everyone gets, it works, we have devices it works on, we have internet for the most part in this country where it works. And now we can finally create that, again, whether it's for education in this case, or it's in medicine with what they're doing in healthcare, or whatever, you know, legal, whatever space you're in, we're finally there.
Interesting. Todd, you probably pitched a few pitch decks with the John Chambers quote in, I'm guessing, there in Silicon Valley over the years. What's your take on how correct or incorrect he was?
Yeah, I think in some ways, Chris, it's less about sort of degree of correctness and more about other foundational shifts that I sort of watched transpire in my career and organizations I've served. And this big piece that maybe hasn't been mentioned yet is this idea of going from a very closed construct to a forced open construct, especially in the workforces. So thinking about, you know, closed L&D departments, sort of closed purchases of content libraries, foundationally changed now.
Yeah, yeah.
You can go out and get anywhere and it will come to you. And so I think there's that big shift of yes, the sort of tsunami is coming. I think Ulrik's spot on, a little bit delayed in timeline. But I think also this idea of just shifting mindset from making sure that all these other aspects of openness in terms of content are available to you. And in some ways that's, I look at companies like lynda.com, right? Sold for $1.5 billion into LinkedIn yeah. Learning. And I was using that in 1996. Also, I'll date myself there a little bit. But that sense of like, micro content, on demand, kind of personalized, no intelligence about it, but you get to pick and choose what you want. It didn't exist inside your company, you went out to get that. And it was a myriad of topics. I think that becomes really, really powerful. Now, I think it's also created, maybe this is a future question, that the bane of our existence, which is content hijacking learning, but we can talk about that in another question.
Yeah, no, I mean, go there. Talk about your point of view on content, because it's a little bit, I think, as Ulrik said, it's like, you know, whatever technology we have at our disposal, we sort of throw it at the learning wall to see how it's going to work. And for the longest time in the internet era, that was all about content, the distribution of content, the development of content, and so on and so forth. But learning's a really broad workload. So what do you think we need to be focused on for our learners as we go forward?
Yeah, I think Irina nailed it, like this idea of, and you at the opening, this human element, like we're missing this component, we're missing this aspect. We just throw content libraries, degree of intelligence behind them or not, personalization or not, AI and ML feeding them or not. If there isn't this aspect of how am I connecting with my fellow man or woman in a professional context and setting, that's really challenging. I don't know, any of you, if you think about any of your most palpable, meaningful, poignant learning experiences, they probably were not done in isolation. Probably weren't necessarily done solo on a mobile device. Probably were involving others. And so that idea of that social piece, I think swinging back is a pendulum. I came from Jive Software many, many years ago, and the idea of trying to make work a better place and the power of, you know, enterprise collaboration, enterprise social networks, I think they missed it on some level, but they had it right when it came to sort of the collective power of bringing everybody together. I think that construct, so if we can do more of that in learning, I think we're on the right path.
Well, that's obviously like your solution really, really sort of pivots around the cohort-based approach and social learning. And I think that's one really good example. But also, say, Michael and Ulrik, I think you have much more personalized kind of strategy. Michael, tell us what your customers are asking you to do for them as a result of this pandemic and all the changes that have gone on.
Yeah, sure thing. So a few things. So I'm 22, and most people in my generation, if you ask them where they learn on two platforms, TikTok and Twitter. And the reason why, and I think this actually ties back to what you said, is that those are the platforms that we use for communication collaboration, right? So it's not, you know, like the conversation of today happens not in person necessarily, but happens on those mediums. And at the same time, if we're thinking about what the end game for corporate learning is, what the end game for learning is in general, right, when it comes to digital learning, in a way it really is the exact right content, right? The exact right nudge at the exact right time, right? If you're operating a forklift, you want to be nudged at the exact right time about how to operate that forklift and reminding you what the safety practices are. Right, if you're a chief executive, right, you want to be nudged how to be a really, you know, empathetic and thoughtful leader at the exact right time.
Maybe though, if I'm the pilot of a 787 coming into land at in Dulles, I don't really want to be nudged. I mean, it might be harder to prepare me for that. So I mean, I'm saying that your focus on learner motivation is really admirable, but it's not the whole picture, is it? I mean, are your customers saying using it discreetly and uniquely?
Yeah, sure thing. So, you know, we have a joke internally that we can't teach you how to fly a jet, but we can, you know, we can remind you how to follow like safety practices as you get on one, right? So I think what we're noticing is that, you know, reinforcement is a huge piece, right? I think a lot of organizations are starting to realize that if you deliver learning at one point in time, and then just let learners be, you're not gonna see the learning outcomes you want, right? So we're starting to see a lot more reinforcement, but at the same time, I think we're starting to see the atomic unit of learning decrease in size, right? I think our customers, which include currently about 5 to 10% of the Fortune 500, are starting to realize that they don't have to pack everything into a 30-minute or hour-long Zoom webinar, especially when the rates of video fatigue are so high, right? They can break things down into minute-long or three-minute-long exercises and achieve pretty much the same results over a longer period of time.
I think most of us who've been on Zoom meetings for hours and hours and hours for the last 18 months will appreciate less is more as a concept. Irina, you wanted to...
Yeah, I just want to jump in and say, I think it's a balance. I think you need a classroom because people, pedagogy is a very long practice and there are methods and a lot of it does work. But you need to be able to deliver it in a modern way, and that involves nudging and that involves micro-learning, and that also involves just bringing that classroom online in a full, as replicated as possible classroom experience online as you can. And that's what certainly drives us, is to how do you take that experience and make it really powerful and not lose a lot and actually gain a lot by doing that. So I do think it's a balance, and it's one that I think all of us are trying to solve, whether it's in corporate L&D or in K-12 or higher ed or whatever it might be.
Yeah, I mean, it's a lovely set of technologies here because it really works in different kind of subsets of the learning workload. With NovoEd being sort of very collaborative and very cohort-driven, and then I think a lot of your work, Ulrik, has been around intense personalization, right, and stripping out content that's not necessary. What have your learners been asking you for over the last 18 months?
Well, so I think over the last 20 years, they've been asking for quick pain relief because we are in complete overload in a large part of the educational system. Like, we've been trying to learn so much, and we've been trying to push people to learn so much that it actually didn't work. So I started out coming into normal education through a lens of, why do doctors and nurses make errors under pressure? What leads to this enormous amount of people who die every year preventably because of human error in medicine? And it led to something that was shocking, which was we do not learn in an efficient way in the first place. And I think that it's really easy to jump to religious points of view about it all needs to be collaboration, or it all needs to be micro-learning, or one or the other. When I grew up in the 70s in Denmark, we thought the world would be a better place if we just sent the kids out in rubber boots in the rain and an acoustic guitar and algebra would follow. It didn't. Big surprise, right? We lost two decades of physicians who cannot do simple multiplications in their heads. You do not want to be a patient in that ICU. So the thing here, it is a balance, but in more than in a third way, actually, than the two that have been brought up, which is we've analyzed on my watch close to 2,000 major curricula in the world, probably substantially more than that, but I've been involved in about 2,000. What's really characterizing all of them is that knowledge will prevail. It will be a really big deal of this in the future. And as knowledge is growing exponentially in the world, we may need to memorize, we may need to store, and may need to master a smaller proportion of it. But I actually has the controversial point of view, probably, which is I think we need to learn more in the future, which means that we're facing a radical problem, which we also need to learn it at a deeper level, because a lot of the things that we can provide quick pain relief compared to how we learned 10, 20 years ago, are the things that will be taken over by algorithms and robotics and just-in-time information systems. So I actually do think that we are facing a really substantial threat, which is unless we learn things deeper, and I'm not sure you can learn things deep in Twitter bite sizes, I actually think that comprehension comes from reflection and getting deeper into things. So I'm a little bit more pessimistic about whether we have found that magic, that magic formula where it's just gamification or it's just one or the other, but I think it's important that some of us divide up and try to figure out different parts of this. How do we solve these? Because it's a pretty big challenge we have ahead of us.
Yeah, I think there's one line of argument that says that there's really an erosion of trust as all this content becomes available and it's easy to get quick answers and things. There's actually a lot of lack of trust in what you're reading, and we've seen that in the political context as well. So it's interesting, you're saying that really we need to teach people to think deeper and to process in real time and be able to sort of decide their own level of trust in what's happening and what they're being fed.
It's the difference between learning facts and comprehending what you're trying to learn. Because if you try to learn 15,000 anatomical things, which I used to teach as independent components, it will take you four times as long or longer compared to if you actually put it into some kind of cohesive and semantically related system in your brain. And that's actually the way the brain works. So we do have a chance to establish our education environment reflecting how the brain works, but that's not where we are today. We're thinking about this as a way you store things in a warehouse.
One of the things that I like about Michael's platform is it's extremely intimate. And SMS texts tend to come from our families and our children, and when you get it, if it's well done, you really taps into that trust. What have you found your learners like about that experience, and is there any risk that it might degrade over time if they're bombarded with content that they don't want?
Yeah, without a doubt. And actually, I couldn't agree more, right? I mean, our perspective is that, you know, in a world where every single bite of learning happens via like texts or Slack or Teams is a very dangerous world, right? But I think you want to get the proportion right? Because one of our clients is the University of Washington, and you know, it's their medical center, right? And one of their biggest problems is that the reason doctors fail at their jobs sometimes is because they've forgotten everything they've learned in those really deep learning experiences, right? So what we find is that learners like the level of intimacy that happens via text, but there needs to be a balance between this deep learning experience that learners inevitably need to have, whether it's via Zoom or whatever platform it's on. They need to have that experience, but they also need sort of the level of intimacy to remind them what they've learned, right? To reinforce the learning, and also to deliver learning nuggets that are new information, right? I think one of the biggest challenges we're going to face as the amount of knowledge gets greater and greater, right, and as the pace at which we have to learn gets greater and greater, is that one-time learning experiences aren't going to cut it, right? Learning just is going to need to be continuous. It's going to be nonstop. And I think our learning platforms haven't adjusted to being and just the way we think about learning hasn't adjusted to being a continuous flow of information, right? Some of it more in depth, some of it smaller. But I think intimacy and trust is sort of tied in with learning being more continuous and being a part of your life, not something you go to once in a while.
Got it. Let's shift gears a little bit, if you don't mind. I want to talk about the future. And there's my favorite quote on the future is William Gibson, who says the future's already here, it's just not evenly distributed. And what it says is there are things bubbling out there that are gonna catch fire and they're gonna make a difference in our world, whether we know it or not. I'd like each of you to just think about, are there technologies that in 20 years' time will have radically changed the workload of learning? And what do you like? What are you thinking about? What do you wish you could see come forward? And can we start with you, Irina?
Yeah, look, I think there's a lot that needs to happen to make an equitable learning experience possible. And I mean everything from, you know, your internet connection is equitable,
yes,
to your device is equitable. I mean, the stories we'll tell you about trying to make our app work on a Chromebook is, you know, and that's today. That's not, yes, the future. In an equitable way to what you can get on, you know, any kind of device. All the way to, you know, I think there's a lot of really powerful and very interesting stuff happening in, you know, whether it's Oculus or whatever VR AI platform that you might be looking at. I think there's a lot of really compelling stuff in medicine, right? Doing training, even now in empathy training, where you're going through scenarios in a simulated environment. So I think there is a lot of just richer content, more engaging content, and the way you deliver that is actually with not just thinking of new content, but actually delivering it with a really compelling technology experience that, again, needs all that infrastructure to be realized.
Love the point on equity of infrastructure access. That is huge, and we could talk a lot about who can make that happen and what kind of partnerships are required to make that happen. Zoom is quite influential in that space, I think so.
Yeah, no, for sure. As are, you know, Google and you know, even Apple, right? I mean, you look at, someone mentioned WhatsApp. I mean, there are entire economies in this world that are being run on basically WhatsApp and that's it, and WeChat. There's a lot of kind of fundamental technology that as you just build up the building blocks, I think the content will follow.
Got it. Todd, what are you and your posse thinking about in terms of future technologies? What would you like to see?
Yeah, I think one of the, obviously the sort of equitable access, the access piece is another huge aspect of that, and we kind of go on a whole tangent about it, but the other piece that I sort of challenge all the L&D talent, HR practitioners, or those that you serve in this world is getting back to this trust piece. And I think, certainly when I talk about workforce or higher end of enterprise corporations, being able to generate a sense of trust of all the corporate knowledge that exists within the organization, and it doesn't have to just come from a L&D department or a line of business, but opening up the faucet a little bit more for not just stagnant user-generated content, UGC, that gets published out to a SharePoint directory or posted up to G Drive, but allowing the folks, and I think this is where some of the technology will come in, of this massive push around sort of the creator market, the makers market, of people doing this in an L&D sense. Yes, is it important that they know pedagogy and andragogy and they can wax poetic about Bloom's taxonomy and can they can produce a level 3 Kirkpatrick assessment? Sure. But do they have to? Because I think if we trust them a bit more and allow that to open up and allow them to generate some of that content and push it out in the world, that's where so much of the corporate memory exists, is inside the organization. And yet we're constantly looking out externally for it.
Yeah, I love that. In the corporate context specifically, we used to say it like Microsoft, there somebody who'd sold a Microsoft Teams deal to a biopharmer in Switzerland knew more about that than anybody at headquarters. Like the knowledge is generated all over the network, and to share and to coach, I think, is kind of an interesting evolutionary step from the kind of work that you guys are doing.
And it feels scary. I mean, I think anybody that works a lot with that entity, the idea, I mean, my master's is in information learning technology with an emphasis in adult learning. So the thought of I'm out here being a proponent for open the floodgates and let others who have zero background contribute to knowledge and acquisition and insights and reinforcement, it needs to happen.
Yeah, that won't be alien to you, Michael, that idea. What do you think is... What do you wish for in terms of technology to help supercharge what you do?
Sure thing. So we spend our days dreaming about the lowest common denominator and how to give them superpowers, right? So for us, we started initially as a way to deliver learning content in the Yemeni war zone, where internet access was super limited. People didn't have laptops, didn't have access to an internet connection. Crazy enough, in the United States today, 10% of workers and 10% of students still don't have access to the internet or a laptop, right? So what we spend all our time thinking about is how can we ensure that the learning experience is great no matter what, and what is that lowest common denominator in terms of the technologies that people use, and how can we make them really powerful, right? In a corporate setting, that's Slack and Teams, and in an interpersonal setting, that's SMS and WhatsApp. For us, we believe that the future is really AI enabled, right? If who here knows what GPT-3 is? Raise your hands. Okay, awesome. A few of you. For those that don't know what it is, when you go home tonight or back to your hotel room, look it up. It'll blow your mind. Essentially, GPT-3 is a natural language processing AI developed by Microsoft and OpenAI that now enables really, really, really well done, essentially AI-based course creation for us in our case, or AI-based text creation for whatever your use case is. For us, the exciting thing about that is that we can start to develop courses completely personalized by AI while essentially give a superpower to that lowest common denominator. So that's what we think about.
Bring on the robots.
That's right.
Bring on the robots. Ulrik.
So again, I think that I'm somewhat biased and beat up after starting with the most sexy parts of education, building full-scale simulators and realizing that they were not going to change the world much unless we solved some of the much more down-to-earth but bigger problems. And I think the biggest impact we'll see over the next, to your original question, 20 years from now, are actually from things that are enabling humans to contribute to the education world and to all these aspects, whether it's collaborative learning or project-based, inquiry-based, knowledge-based acquisition, whatever it is. I think it's using technology to give the human brain superpowers are an ability to deliver at a higher quality, a higher pace, at a cheaper cost, with much higher quality than a lot of the stuff we do today, because I think that's the reason why we've lost trust in it. It is, like, to be honest, most e-learning doesn't work. Most classroom-based learning has issues and is somewhat a waste of time. So the thing is that if we have to regain that trust, I think the only way to do that and to get to that higher level of comprehension is we need human brains involved in it. And if you look at all the big breakthroughs, I watched Apollo 11 on the plane over yesterday. It was actually humans using technology. And there are still humans whenever we solve these things. I don't think we're going to see that magic black box of AI that are going to get the idea for the next way to solve hard problems. But we are totally using technology to enable human engineers and scientists and all kinds of human contributions in a different way. And I think that's where we'll see the big difference. So we also deeply engaged in using GPT-3, but it's for really down-to-earth things that are just speeding up and enabling humans to make much more qualified contributions. I think we'll see a revolution there.
So maybe CRISPR and pharmacology is we'll be talking about in 10 years' time. Can we finish on a question? I have a podcast called Learning is the New Working. You should all check it out. I ask everybody who comes on the podcast why they do the work they do. I think there's something kind of a little bit special about the learning space. So we've got 9 minutes and 19 seconds. So can you distill why you decided to focus your career around learning? Ulrik, you can go first.
Yeah, so I sold my first education company a month before I graduated as a physician. So I really profoundly believed that I wanted to become a physician up until a year or so before that. And it was actually because I could see that there was a much bigger chance to make an impact to try, and initially I was only focused on medical education, but I realized that there was a much bigger chance to make that impact and really reach more than treating one patient at a time, actually being able to make systemic impact through education. And I think that I later realized that that's the passion that lots of educators around the world shares. Yeah. That it is fundamentally this idea that if you really want to change something, whether it's an unfair political system, whether it's inequality, it's probably a good idea to start with education. So it's like with population geneticists or others who are looking at things at scale, I think it's deeply fascinating how profound changes we can generate that way. And as an example, like, the largest program we've ever worked on is American Heart Association, that profoundly has changed over the last 20, 30 years what happens when one of us get acutely ill all over the world. And we today, just while we have the session, we'll probably have onboarded another 800 to 1,000 doctors and nurses who will get their validated science-based, consensus-based education and certifications that will help, like, just for those few hundreds, thousands of patients in the future.
I love it. I'm watching the clock. We're tight. Michael.
Sure thing. So I'm obsessed with meeting people where they are, right? And the reality is, whether you're Gen Z or whether you're not Gen Z, when technology can meet you where they are, it has a transformative impact. And for us in a learning context, the way we think about that is, if you're a single mother of two, digital learning is not designed for you today, right? Video courses are not designed for you. Many of the single parents that we work with, right, for example, don't have time to sit down for an hour and a half and watch the video course, right? They simply do not have the time, nor in many cases do they have the technology. So for us, that's what drives us, right? Is how can we create, how can we create learning experiences that can be genuinely accessed by anybody, no matter the technology they use, no matter the time they have. We may not be able to get them to a full level, right? We may not be able to get them to fly a jet, right? But we can get them somewhere, and that's what matters a lot. That's what we're obsessed with.
Got it. Todd.
Yeah, I mean, certainly my origin story of how to get into the space, I can think of few professions that create the fuel to transform so much. And I think of learning, I came from a family of educators in higher ed, but one of my first experiences out of undergrad was trying to start OBP, the Outward Bound Professional, the corporate professional development, learning and training arm of Outward Bound, that folks know that. And I was 21 years old, and I was leading a debrief with 50 consultants from Morgan Stanley, execs of a senior level that I should not be talking to, after a high ropes exercise in the middle of Leadville, Colorado, at 7,000 feet and watching the transformative power of training and education in a totally unisolated experiential sense and what that could do to that group was something I said, I'm hooked. All these folks want to get better. They want to improve for their teams, for their firm, for the organization. And that's something exceedingly powerful that has led me on this meandering path.
Watching the light bulbs go off. Love it.
On top of a snake pole, which is a 100-foot pole set up in the top of the air, 8 inches round. You have to stand on it and jump 15 feet out into a trapeze that you're purposely not meant to catch. And the whole concept behind that is to, to draw failure and loss.
Interesting to know how you do that on NovoEd, but it's fine. Irene.
So I wasn't on a trapeze, but I think, you know, why we do what we do at class is because we think that what we're doing is going to change the way the world learns by giving the world more access and making it much more simple to access a quality education, whatever you consider quality.
Yeah.
And so for us, it's hard not to get excited by that given how fundamental education is to everything. So that's why what we do and why we started it only 12 months ago and are just as pumped as we were then now.
Unbelievable, unbelievable. A really fantastic range of technologies, all working on different parts of the learning workload, all at different points of maturity, all focused on giving people equal access to opportunity through learning. I love it, and I love that. I love that tagline for the conference. So thanks, guys, for joining us, for sharing. People can connect with you through the app or through LinkedIn, I'm sure. Thanks for doing the work you do, and good luck going forward. And I've been asked to say, if you want to talk to these amazing people, can we do that outside in the corridor? Because we have to make space for the next group. Thank you for listening. I hope it was inspiring for you, and enjoy the rest of the conference. Thanks.